good evening. During my 30 plus years mountaineering, I've climbed many peaks across the world, many of them glaciated, placid in snow and ice, high altitude peaks, but not all. In 2007, I climbed the tallest peak in Madagascar, Maromokotro, 2,800 metres. Not high at all in international standards, but quite a peak to get to, and certainly a heck of a peak to get back from. I'd been inspired by Guatemalan climber Jaime Vinales, who I'd met on Baffin Island a few years before, to go and climb this peak. And when I did, it became apparent to me that Jaime was the last non-Malagasy person they'd seen, and we're talking 2 and 3 years before. That's how remote and quiet this peak is. It's a good week's walk in with the crew, the local crew, and you become very obviously apparent that there are no luxuries that we might think of in the West. And when I say luxuries, no running water, no electricity, nothing. I had the only electric light for miles, which was a battery operated headlamp. We summited safely. It's not a technical peak at all. In fact, it reminds me of my native Derbyshire, the dark peak, bog ridden, black granite, really homely, bizarrely, but with great tradition. You can't just turn up and walk up these things. You must talk to the local village headman and gain permission. And then you will have to carry out certain rites and rituals on the summit. Otherwise, you're not going anywhere near. And these involved honey, alcohol, money, prayer, and one thing I'll mention in the letter. That all seemed so easy. Coming back was another thing, because we chose a different route home, and particularly the first day was one of the toughest jungle days I think I've ever had in my life. There was no path. We're trying to bash our way through practically virgin rainforest to find a way to get to a river. And once we're at the river, we know we cross it and we'll get to a village, and that's fine. But it's getting to the river. We could hear it for hours. We could not get down to it. It was down probably a 45 degree one in one slope, heavily jungled and full of thorns and cut bamboo and horrible bitey things. It was a heck of a travelling journey to get down this damn thing. And we went through the night, with me having the one head torch and the locals making bamboo torches, trying to bash our way down. And eventually, way past dark, we found the river and we just camped. The next day we crossed it and went to the village and just took a day off. We were in a heck of a state. But then we had another week's walking out to get back to our starting point, and where, of course, I could return home. And it was there I realised what I'd been missing, because I'd been so focused on my mountaineering that I'd forgotten my love at home. It was a great mistake in my life. And it's quite sadly documented that people fall in love with their jobs and they fall in love with their pastimes and they forget the people they love. Cheers. And so here is my love letter to Maromokotro. Dearest Em, how do I describe the toils that I undertook in an effort to meet you? I crossed the globe many times to earn the respect of your elders before I felt able to approach your side. I now understand why so few people knock at your door. You are single, alone, and daunting. Yet you easily revealed the child within me. We shared many tears in the height of our time together, and I didn't want to leave you, but my own love was calling me from across the seas. She knew little of our rendezvous, and our time together broke so many rules. But I felt compelled to see you. We sat with our hands entwined in silent harmony, in your unparalleled views as eagles soared high above our heads. It was a truly unforgettable moment. You requested some unusual gifts, and I left them as a token as our time together. Quite what you wanted with a white chicken, I'm not sure, but it wasn't for me to question. You have your traditions, as I have mine. We parted without a word. I hacked through the darkness and waded a deep river gorge before crossing the emptiness of your island to return to my own love. But it was not to be. She was tired of my Casanova adventuring, and when I returned home, I found myself abandoned. I played too many hands at once and paid the price for my philandering. I must try to get her back before the blood of Eden has run too far. And so, this must be my final adieu. Sleep well, my sweet. Good night.